Good morning and welcome to this session on what to get the most, how to get the best out of your first-time managers. Before I get into the core subject, which is a very is something I hold very close to my heart because of having all kinds of issues with this area, I just want to give you a brief update on our company. We are a company that was formed about 3 years ago. And we call ourselves Track to Results, which is short for transforming strategies into tangible business results. We did a lot of work on various areas of operational and sales execution. We found that most of the time, you know, people are concerned and willing to put a lot of energy and resources behind sales execution, and that's the reason why we framed our you know, the overall structure. So we position ourselves as a company that's focused on sales excellence, which has two parts, the sales operations part and the sales execution part. And how we differentiate ourselves is that in most of the cases, sales organizations tend to believe that putting more and more resources, training, you know, consulting and so on, behind improving their sales staff is the road to improved sales. What they often miss out is that if you don't have a strong sales operations framework in the background and a good sales execution model in the front, the likelihood of scaling your sales operations is very limited. It's really restricted to how hard people work, and that's never going to be a scalable model. In doing so, we've done about 30-odd projects in this area, or rather I would say 30-odd companies, several projects, some of them are repeat projects. We also found that there are some skill gaps, and those skill gaps mostly we found were with people leaving too much value on the table, you know, doing transactional selling. So we do some interventions on creating customer value. The other place where people leave a lot of money on the table is by not negotiating strategically. Most negotiations almost end up being like, you know, this is what I'm offering, here's what the customer wants, and so we'll settle somewhere in between. That often leaves just way too much at the table. The third area that we looked at as we worked through our sales operations and sales execution models is exactly the spot that we are at today. What are the fundamentals of management that you need to take to your frontline managers or to your first-time managers? That's going to drive any sales operation, sales execution, or for that matter, any initiative in any line of the business that you want to be driven effectively. Some of it also translates into the middle-level management, which is the leadership area that we talk about. So this is broadly what we do. We've had some good results. Our objective is not to bring linear results. All businesses and all the managers in those businesses are good at doing that. We want to drive non-linear results, things that you won't achieve if you keep doing things the way you've been doing. And here are some results that we got. We're in the third year of working with this company in the industrial automation space, and it's now 2 years since they've been growing their revenue at 2x of what the market is growing. Their growth rates are 2x of what the market is growing. I should change this part of the slide because we're talking about Europe's largest engineering company here. In the electrical engineering space, we worked with them on a culture change project. The core objective was to drive their net promoter score up from fairly low number to about double, so 19 to 38 is what they were talking about. They've now this year, so in the second year they got to 43, in the third year now they've got to 54. So it's nearly 2.5 times that we've been able to help them drive it. Another example of a tier one auto component manufacturing company, which in which we were able to help them execute some of their some of the things that they do at the factory really well, to increase their four walls profit from 14%, which looks pretty good, but actually, usually what we look at, what people end up doing is that you have someone who's really good at what they do. They perform a certain set of tasks, and they're driving business results. And rightly, you know, I suppose we consider that these are the individual contributors who are going to be, you know, our next line of managers. And that's where we make a very significant transition. This transition is not just in the career of the individual concerned. This is also one of the most important transitions that organizations make with their workforce, because most of the managers or most of the people who do the actual work on the ground are at this level and are managed by people at the frontline manager level. This transition means that this person now becomes a manager. And instead of performing tasks that are directly in his control to achieve his business results, he now has a lot of other individual contributors who are probably experts at what they do, which is the tasks that they are performing, to drive the manager's results. And there is an assumption that a lot of us make out here, and that assumption is that just because this individual contributor is good at what he does, therefore he will also be good at managing other people who do what they do. And that's a big mistake, because, in fact, that's a big gap, because we almost never give inputs to these individuals who move from individual contributors into becoming managers of people, because these little boxes, the blue boxes that were activities that they had control over, now are going to be a completely different set of blue boxes that they need to do to be able to effectively manage the people that that are in their teams. That's the big transition that that we're talking about. Now, there are two parts to this. Let me be very clear. For this to be successful, one part of it is the individual learning of the person who's moving into this new manager position. The other part is, what's the role of the leader in enabling and facilitating that? Now, the topic of our webinar today is how to get the most from your first-time managers. So I am going to be talking primarily from a point of view of what's the leader's role in enabling a new manager to become effective at what he does. So let's keep that in context. The transition isn't complete till both those things happen, but today's topic is really about getting the most as a leader from your first-time managers. So let's look at what the leader's role is in managing this transition. Let me also be very clear. These transitions don't happen by accident. If you leave it to the will of God to make this, it will be the will of God that you will see at the end of it. If you if you choose to design where this should go, that's where the role of the leader really comes in. And the leader doesn't play a role in managing this transition. The transition will turn out to be something that might, in most cases, be quite unexpected and quite different from what the leader expects, by which time it's too late for the leader to do anything about it. So he just keeps managing, you know, challenge after challenge that comes up, because people down the line somehow just don't seem to be doing what they're expected to do. So let me just bring up what is the core of the leader's role. The leader's not going to do the job of this first-time manager. The leader is only going to facilitate this person and is going to empower this person to be able to do their job well. Now, we have four things on offer when we talk about what these things could be. How do you facilitate? How do you empower people who become first-time managers? In fact, I would even go to the extent of saying it's not just about first-time managers, it's really about frontline managers, the guys on the front line who are doing, who are managing the people who do the day-to-day job. So we're offering basically four areas in the discussion today, and these areas are as follows. Do people who move into these roles where they're going to manage new people understand the purpose of why we are in business or what we are doing? And I'll come to why that's important. So clarity clarity at multiple levels is something that needs to be taken care of. It's not only clarity about what results the person is supposed to generate. It's about a lot of other things, and I'll just come to that. The second thing that's important from a leader's perspective, or a key role for a leader to play, is to align the role that this person is getting into and whatever responsibilities they have with the systems and processes. In fact, these systems and processes need to be aligned towards the achievement of the business objective of the leader. The third one is, now that we've put the person in this place, as a frontline manager, as a first-time manager, how do we maximize the potential? Where the potential exists, we know it. They have performed. They have shown some results. That's why they are being made. They are being made managers. But just leaving it to that and then hoping and praying that they will live up to their potential for the new role that they know very little about is exactly that. It's a hope cast. It's no. It's not a structured way of. Or it's not a way in which you actually end up leveraging the potential of or the human capital in your organization in a structured way. And the fourth area that that we'll talk about today is how does the leader create an environment in which people can actually give their best, which is an environment in which there is a high level of trust. Because when there's a high level of trust, it automatically creates more autonomy, more empowerment. And when there's more autonomy and more empowerment, then the speed of doing things is pretty fast. And the cost of doing things is quite low. So, you know, those are the four areas that that a leader could significantly contribute in to facilitate the success of first-time managers and to empower first-time managers in whatever it is that they're trying to do. So let me just move forward from here and talk about defining a clear purpose. Very often the way a clear purpose is defined is to say, here is your PRA, here is the business result that we want, here are the two or three metrics that we're going to use to measure it. Now go run, right? Which is fine. I mean, it does clarify some parts of what the individual needs to do. But what we are saying is there are actually three areas in which a person who's moving into a management position, a people management position, needs to be absolutely clear about. The first is, if you look at the center, what is his role? Got it? No problem. All of us invest a lot of time in doing that. And we keep on reiterating what those expectations are, but I'm not sure that a lot of us actually go out and say what are the organization's objectives and how does your role align with it, right? Or for that matter, the third area, what are the critical impact areas that that you should look at creating given the role that you're in, and you know, what is the purpose of that role within the organization? So if you look at an organizational level, you know, these things, you know, they may exist. Most organizations have a vision, a mission. Most of them have a strategy that they're going after. But my own experience of having managed people, of having, you know, promoted people from individual contributors to people managers is that if you ask six such people or seven such people sitting in a room a simple question, saying what are the values of our company? I would be very surprised if six of them could give me the answer straight, saying, sir, they are 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. And this is not a problem that you have only at the level of the frontline managers. It's a problem that you have all across an organization. I'd be very, very surprised, in fact, if you put 6, 7 people from the middle of an organization into a room, you know, middle-level managers, 10, 12, 15 years of experience, and say, right, can you tell me all 6 of you, 7 of you, what are the values of our company? That I'd get a straight answer for that. Why is that important? I think that's really important in a very simple context. As an individual, if you are misaligned with the vision, mission, strategy, or values or culture of the organization, the impact of that misalignment is limited to you as an individual. But as a manager, as you start getting misaligned, or if you are misaligned with any of these five really important things, you are now, you know, your impact is multiplied by the number of people who work for you. So if you become a first-time manager and, you know, you are not that well aligned, let's say, with the culture of the organization. The culture of the organization is one, let's say, which is very open. It's one of transparency. And you believe in your management style and you're misaligned that, you know, you don't need to share all the information that that you have with everybody in the organization. You can bet it's going to create a lot of trouble, right? If you believe that, you know, that it's my job as a leader, say a sales manager in a particular region, is to generate the revenue number of the organization. You know, if I generate the revenue number, it really doesn't matter what are some of the things I do, you know, underneath. I could do bad business. I mean, I could do undercutting. I could do, I could play one channel partner against another channel partner to try and get the customer the lowest price. I could make commitments to the customer that are not on paper, and then you know somebody else has to fulfill them. Basically, I'm saying, you know, my role is to generate the numbers, but I'm misaligned with the culture and the values of the organization. It can only lead to trouble, and it ends up having leaders trying to, you know, having to clean up a lot of muck that they need not have created if they had made the vision, mission, strategy, culture, and values of an organization clear to the people who are moving into management roles, and to the people who are actually doing the real work on the ground, because that's where, you know, what you do is eventually what's going to determine whether people see your company as having the vision, mission, strategy, culture, and values that it supposedly, you know, that it supposedly has, because that's what the CEO talks about. That's the reason why it's really important for people moving into management positions to have tremendous clarity about what the organizational objectives or visions, you know, what their strategy is, what the culture is, and what the value is. Only then comes the role. In the role, the first thing that's important to understand is how does your role align with the five things that are on the left-hand side, right? In other words, why have we created this role? Why are you in this role? How does it fulfill our strategy? How does it fulfill our mission? And therefore, how does it feed into our vision? Now, in some cases, it may, you know, the vision and mission may be too far away. But the fact is, at a frontline manager level, you definitely need to be, your role needs to be definitely aligned with the strategy of the company. It has to reflect the culture of the company and the values. Because now, you have to manage people, which is the fourth box in this pillar called role. And you have to reflect the vision, mission, strategy, culture, and values of your company to those people. And so that alignment becomes really important. What unfortunately happens most of the time is we end up spending most of our time defining objectives and the results that we want from people, or people who become managers. So that's important. When I say unfortunate, I'm not saying it's a bad thing. I think it's important, but it's only part of what needs to be done to drive the result that we want. Because eventually, whatever results we are trying to achieve here or out here in the middle are going to be driven by people, processes, and if you stretch a point, the systems that support those processes in an organization. So I think these things need to become extremely clear to people who are moving into management positions, and that's a key role that a leader can play, and a leader at any level. Right? If you're a manager of that manager, you become the leader for that manager. I think the third area that we often tend to miss out on by staying very focused on objectives and results is the impact that we expect a new manager to create. Now, you could create significant impact by simply, the performance against your objectives and results, and that's necessary, because if you create that, if you deliver that level of performance, and in fact start looking beyond that and saying how can I deliver more than what is expected from me as a result, then you start creating impact. Otherwise, you're only fulfilling an expectation. And there's a big difference between somebody who's creating impact through their performance and somebody who's just fulfilling expectations. So I think the performance impact is something that needs to be understood clearly. I think a couple of the key areas that we don't look at, largely because we just fill these positions because they have to do a certain job, is to see that if we are taking somebody out of a group of people and putting them at a higher level, then what is the unique value that we expect them to create? Right? What's value? Value at the end of the day is what can you do for this business, or what can you do for your people that we haven't thought about before? How can you use your past experience or your creativity or your innovation to create something in this role that hasn't been created before, because of which we can then earmark you for bigger things? We almost never talk about unique value, and we almost always end up only evaluating people on what kind of performance they've delivered against the results. And as a result of which, you know, if they're able to deliver higher levels of performance and unique value, then that becomes significant contribution to a specific area in the business. Have you contributed to improving process? Have you contributed to creating spectacular people? Have you contributed to creating something that we couldn't have that nobody had thought about in the past? What's your unique contribution? What value have you created? What is the contribution? What is the performance that you've given? I think if you just look at these, you know, these are, if I count them, there are, these are 13 areas. They are by no means the only areas that you want to look at, but these are some significant areas that you could look at for creating a 360-degree clarity in the mind of a new manager about where exactly they're going. Now, having gone through this conversation on this slide, I do understand that, you know, when you talk about so many things to an individual, sometimes it can get a bit overwhelming. And so it's important to then hunker down and say, hey, that's fine, but you know, when we look at the business result, or when we look at the performance area or the unique value that you're trying to create, what is the area in which you want to create that unique value? You have to do your day job. I mean, you know, you have to fill reports, you have to go to meetings, you have to meet customers, you have to manage your production cycles, whatever your role is. You have to do your day job. But what are one or two areas in which you want to create a significant impact? You know, the right-hand side of the previous slide, this stuff. What unique value or what unique contribution do you want to create while you continue to do your day job, which is in the middle out here? And I think that's, you know, that's important to talk to people about for two reasons. One is you want to narrow down the number of things they're thinking of. Remember, they just moved into a big role, so or into a bigger role, and so they're now probably feeling very charged up about it, and they want to change the whole world, which is impossible. And the second is to sort of give them a more realistic framework in which to perform. So, you know, there's no point trying to do everything. People will be tempted to do everything because they now suddenly start feeling like Superman because they moved into a new role. But there's enough and more research to prove that, you know, the law of diminishing returns is well and truly alive, because if you take anything more than two or three really big things out of your, you know, whatever your job is, you're probably not going to achieve them with a great deal of success. So when we are talking about clarity, not only do we talk about organizational clarity, role clarity, and impact clarity, but we also say exactly in which areas are you going to deliver that, and not let that become a runaway kind of thing and just have one or two areas in which you want to focus. Because that's how you drive significant result. I mean, if you can create that focus by having that discussion, if you can engage the employee by ensuring that they know exactly what they're supposed to achieve, and that, you know, they're totally aligned with their management on that, and you can create the discipline, you know, that's when you're going to start creating significant impact. Because if you don't have these three things in place clearly in the minds of people, leaders, then you know when you look at this grid, you could end up being anywhere. A team with high focus but low level of engagement will probably get you incremental results, 2%, 3% growth, something like that. If you have a completely confused leader and a completely confused team, you probably have no results at all. If you have people who are fully charged, a manager who's just become a manager and is really charged with what he's doing, but doesn't know whether he's going north or south, you're probably going to get short-term results every now and then and not be able to drive what you really want, which is consistent and superior performance levels. And so, you know, because we want to move everyone here, it's important to create that focus. So, you know, that's really what I wanted to talk about, the first of the four things. What are the areas in which we want to create clarity in the minds of our managers? Now, you can create clarity, but it's equally important as a leader to ensure that whatever it is that we've created clarity about, or whatever it is that the direction that we've set for people, that the systems and processes underneath are supporting that, you know, that particular initiative. I've seen so many of these initiatives in my career where, you know, some grand statements are made about what we're going to do, and everybody, you know, waves their flags and shouts loudly that we are right behind you, and you know, we're going to achieve this big goal and so on. And then they suddenly go out and discover that they, you know, that they don't have the resources, or they don't have a system in which to record the stuff, or they don't have the right metrics, or they don't have the workflow, or, you know, a critical department in helping them achieve that success. The moment you go to them for some clarity or for some action to be taken, they look at you as though, you know, you're talking Greek and Latin, and they have no idea what you're saying. So it's really important that that as leaders, when we put new managers in their new roles and give them the clarity about what they want to do, that we are also aligning our systems and processes behind the success of those behind the success of those initiatives. Now, what's a great system? Let's have a look at that. It's aligned to achieve your most important goals. Now, where do the most important goals come from? They come from that chart that we saw just some time back. 2 to 3 big rocks. What are the really big things that you want to achieve? It's a system that creates the environment and the support structures that enables people to give their best, best solutions. It's totally independent of the leader or the manager. It's a system. It just works, every time. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter whether there's somebody at the helm or there isn't, or whether that person is good or bad. And it's something that needs to be sustainable, that can endure over a period of time. So it needs to be designed to do that. Now, as a leader, it's important for you to invest into creating these systems and not just letting your frontline managers or first-time managers try and figure this out on their own. That's inherently risky. Now, we think there are 6 parts to carry out the most important work that that an organization has. You can actually abstract it up to that level. I understand in every business, in every role, the issues may be different, but it is possible to abstract it up to a level so that it becomes agnostic of industry and the type of role that a person is performing. So we've broken that into 6 parts. Here they are. Right. First of all, what's the process that you're trying to drive? Very often there is a lack of clarity on that itself. The second is, what are the tasks that need to be performed? The third is, who's going to do what? And that's really mapping the process to people. The fourth one, to the team. The fourth one is, how do we know whether we're succeeding or we're not succeeding? So what are the metrics that that we have for each process point that we have created in the third point, which is map the process, so that we can measure whether it's been done or not. The fifth is obvious. It's no point measuring something if you're not going to evaluate it. And the sixth is, if you're not getting anywhere with it, how do we improve the process? This is a high level abstraction, but it can be applied to virtually any role that's coming up. Question often comes up: do I, as a leader, need to create this? Well, your frontline manager could create it too. Your first-time manager could create it too. But it certainly needs the leader to be aligned, so that everybody is working towards the same purpose, and so that you can bring to bear your better experience of how the business works, what are some of the moving parts, what are some of the challenges, who are the stakeholders, what is their likely behavior, what's the culture of the organization. I think you can add a great deal of soft value to this, because frankly, anybody can create a flowchart. Anybody can create a flow diagram. So, if you have to design this in a realistic kind of environment, I would certainly feel that the leader has a significant role to play in this. Now, these are statements, words, and so on and so forth. I'm just going to breeze through the next 5 or 6 slides, because they're indicative of how you could design this. We're not going to go and sit and design this today, but this gives you some indicators of what it's all about. So our first building block is identifying the process, and there are 4 things that that we would say let's put down as the process checks that that we want to set up. Obviously, it's got to do with results. So the first thing is, what are those results that you have to deliver? Let's be clear that a person who's moving into a frontline manager position probably has a lot of upstream and downstream dependencies, and so it's very important to define, where does the process start for this particular manager and his team, and where does the process end? Because otherwise, you get caught up in the gray areas on the boundaries, and nothing ever moves, right? And I think a critically important aspect of this is to clearly understand what is the thing that I produce from this process that has value for somebody. So many times I've seen people working on processes because they have to work on a process. What does it produce, and how does it matter to the most important goals that you're trying to achieve? just becomes a, you know, back-end secondary kind of an issue. And I think that's a value that you can create as a manager for as a leader for the first-time manager. The second building block is very tactical. It's just about identifying the tasks, but I think it's important to understand ownership and decision points on these tasks. Everybody knows this, but what you know is not important. What you do is what eventually gets the results. We all know that, you know, you need to identify tasks and you need to identify owners and you need to identify who's going to make the decisions. But yet, when I sit in on business meetings, it is remarkable the number of times, the conversation goes out saying, we should do this and we should do that. I mean, I often ask, you know, this electrical European manufacturing company that we spoke about, a lot of people would say that. We should do this and we should do that. There are 17,000 employees in that company. My first question used to be, who's we? Right? And I think that specificity and that level of detailing is something that we often miss out and expect that somebody else will do. Everybody is expecting somebody else to do it, and it just gets it just gets left out in the pool. I think the third building block is to map the process. So once you've got the tasks, the frontline manager or the first-time manager has his team. He has his own roles. Now, this could be looked at as a matrix that you create for the first-time manager's roles. Role 1, role 2, role 3, role 4, therefore, what are the tasks you're going to do? It also works in saying, okay, this is my team. We have a process, and the process produces the following thing of value to somebody. And to produce the following thing of value, person 1, person 2, person 3, person 4 perform the following tasks. So it's a very simple, way of saying, okay, you know, if we have to get a job done that produces something of value from our process, here's how we're going to map the process to roles within the organization or roles for an individual or both, and therefore get again a very high level of clarity on what is the task at hand. So it's really about building the processes. The fourth building block is what are my process metrics? And I think the fundamental question to be asked is, how do you know whether your process is working well, is sort of just about struggling along, or is not working at all, right? And for that, it's important to say, what are we going to measure, and how are these measured, reviewed, and how often are they going to be measured? I'm currently doing a project with a large travel company. Just in case some of you are wondering, wow, this is simple stuff. Why are we even talking about this? I'm doing a project with a large travel company. It's a national company, and I asked them, what's the most important goal that your organization has? What would that one thing be that's most important to you? And they said, well, we think it's got to be market share. And I said, right. So what's your market share right now? And they said, well, in our industry, there's no measurement of market share. My fundamental question to the managing director of the company was, if you don't know what your market share is, how do you know what you want it to be? And if you don't know what the market share of other people, in your trade is, how on earth are you going to figure out whether you're being successful or not? And if you had to measure market share, what would those metrics be? Right? They eventually trundled out something, and they trundled out a couple of them saying, it could be the number of referral customers that we get, and it would be the number of repeat customers that we get. So we know that creates customer satisfaction, and when there's customer satisfaction, then you're going to increase your market share. I said, what's your customer satisfaction number? He said, well, we don't measure it. Now that's reality for a really large travel company, which is a white collar kind of an environment with lots of IT supported systems, and therefore presumably a lot of data available to them, who don't know, at their management level, they don't know these numbers. And I'm not surprised that, it doesn't filter down to their, right through their management lines. So this is a really important aspect. Many of us just tend to miss out on this completely. The fifth building block is, how do you evaluate the process? And that's quite simple. I mean, there's about six parameters that that you could look at. You could create your own parameters. In our model, we have 6 parameters. You just say, what's my process that I'm talking about? Is it aligned to the goals that we have? Does it include everybody in the organization, or is it just one or two people who are doing it? Is it independent of other processes, or is it dependent on other processes? Will it endure if the people leave? So is the process dependent on people, or are people following a process that is agnostic to who are the people in there? Can we identify areas to improve? Can we influence this process? Is it within our control, and so on? However, our parameters are only a set of parameters. You can define your own parameters, but certainly have ways in which in which the process can be evaluated. The sixth of the building blocks is, how do you improve the processes? So which process, who, which steps need to be improved, what improvement needs to be done, by when do they need to be done? These are, again, parameters that could be defined specific to the business. In our model, we do these 4. But I would encourage some thought that goes in at some level of detail when you are getting these frontline managers in. You've given them clarity about their goals, but when you are creating the processes and systems to support them to achieve those goals, you could look at either all of these 6 building blocks, or you could look at some of these 6 building blocks that you think are really important to help them be successful with whatever are the impact goals or the business goals that you've created for them. And so that's, and again, I'd say I would shudder to think that, if we just left the frontline manager or the first-time manager to do this himself, that he'd be able to do it. I think it's a significant leadership intervention, and this is what leaders can do to get the maximum out of their frontline managers on the second pillar, which is create supporting systems and processes. Now, that's the hard part. You've created the goals, and you've given them clarity, and you've created the systems and the processes and all of that stuff. Now you've got to see how this person is actually going to perform on the ground, and how are you going to maximize the potential that you saw in this person to promote them into being a first-time manager for your business. We look at 4 levers in this area, and those levers really are about, what are the leadership conversations we are having with them? What's the kind of engagement I have with this, or what's the level of engagement that this manager is showing? And there are actually many levels of engagement. I'll show you some of them. We'll only look at them at a high level, but it's important to be conscious of that. How do we manage performance? It's one thing to have leadership conversations and to keep the employee engaged, but it's another to hold them accountable to perform against the goals that we've set for them. And fourthly, and most importantly, it's okay to hold people accountable because you are their manager and they are in the job to perform a certain set of things. But as a manager, as a leader, you're also in a position where you should be supporting them in helping them achieve their goals. In my experience, people do this, but I think the balance between managing somebody's performance and holding them accountable on one side and helping them be successful is totally skewed towards managing performance. 9 times out of 10, the conversation is about, why did you not do something, or why did you not achieve something? And only 1 time out of 10 is, come, let me help you with what you need to do. I'm not sure what the right balance is, but it certainly cannot be a 9-1. It has to be somewhere between a 5-5 and a 9-1. So that's the fourth. Those are the 4 levers we look at for enabling these people. So what are leadership conversations? Now, I've had many interesting leadership conversations with people that have led me. Unfortunately, I have not seen a pattern in any of them. I worked for a multinational corporation for most of my life. Most of my 20 years of my professional career, I spent about 17 of those in Microsoft and Oracle. The turnover of managers was very high in those companies. Everybody moves out of a role in 2 years. So every 2 years, you had a new manager, either because a new manager came into a position of your manager, or you moved to some other role, and therefore you were reporting to another manager. There was no pattern at all in the leadership conversations that we were having. Some people were, coffee house managers. They would take you to a coffee shop every 2 weeks, have a conversation about your family and stuff like that. Some of them were hard taskmasters. They would just sit there and beat you up all the time. Some of them would just leave you alone. You go do what you have to do. You swim or sink. It's not my problem. Some of them would be sitting on your head all the time saying, let me tell you what you need to do to be successful. There was no consistency. And so, when we look at this model, we are saying, let's have some consistency in this. There are three types of leadership conversations in our world. The first type is what we call the affirmation type, where there's a leadership conversation with a frontline manager, with a first-time manager that's talking about reiterating the confidence that you have reposed in that person's ability, which is what we refer to as affirming the worth of that individual to the business, and affirming their potential to the team. And that's one category of conversation. The second category of conversation is squarely in the performance area, but there are two very clear things. Most people tend to spend only a little bit of time in clarifying expectations by writing down KRAs and job descriptions, and then spend most of the time in creating accountability or holding people accountable. We think there's need for a balance on that. We definitely need to spend much more time on clarifying expectations than we do right now. But on the performance side, there's a couple of conversations. Clarify expectations and create accountability that need to be had reasonably frequently. And the third type of conversation is to be a source of support. So the first thing is, I keep on reiterating that I believe that you have a very high worth. I believe in your potential. However, on the performance side, here are my expectations. So let us not be fooled about that. I clearly expect this, and I'm going to hold you accountable. Yet, when you feel that you need some kind of help to be able to achieve that, I will be a source of support. So it's a good 360-degree set of things, about five or six things that you can use in leadership conversations. It's a tango. It's a skill that has to be developed. One has to keep moving from one to the other depending on what the situation is. There's no formula that says, please try number three first and then number two after that, number five should come third. There's no such sequence. There's also no balance that we say should happen in any specific conversation. We are not saying you should talk about all five things in all five conversations. In all conversations. We're just saying that these are the five areas that leadership conversations should balance. So what are the characteristics of the conversation? I think it's important to understand that when you're in a position of leadership, every conversation that you have is being seen as a message from the leader. And every word that you say, people hang on to and interpret in all sorts of ways. So it's really important to make sure that you're clear about what you're saying in our conversations to people. Because what we say and how it's interpreted is what drives behavior amongst people, and when a collective set of people behave in a certain way, that's what we say is the culture of the organization. Right. So that's the first thing to keep in mind. The second is, you can have as many conversations as you like looking at spreadsheets. They're important to have. They teach us a few things about what's going on with our business. They give us insights and things like that. But it's the conversations about setting clear expectations, holding people accountable to those expectations, reiterating your confidence in their ability and their worth, and helping them out when they're stuck with something, and not saying, I don't care, you were hired into this job to figure these things out, now go figure it out. That's setting people up for failure. But if you do follow these four or five areas, there's a higher probability that they are going to drive success and results from your team and your team managers than simply holding people accountable to what shows up in a spreadsheet. Now, these five areas of conversation can be in any real format. I mean, they can be anywhere. They could be cooler side conversations. They could be smoke break conversations. They could be formal review conversations. It's not important where you hold these conversations, but these are the five areas that we believe need importance. They're not the only things, don't get me wrong. You can have your normal conversations the way you have them, but you need to pepper them with these five areas and they could be of good help in ensuring that people who move into new management positions are getting the right strokes when it comes to comes to performance, right? One tip that that I would certainly say here is always look for an opportunity to convert one of these. You know, always look to convert any conversation you're having into a conversation of this kind, into a leadership conversation. It becomes a style of working, and it, you know, you're basically then talking about the most important things to your people. I spoke about engagement levels, and I think it's important to understand that various people, and this applies to everybody really in the team, it's not just about your frontline managers, everybody fits into one of these boxes. People are either below the line in the red area, in the red zone, you know, where they're ready to quit, or they're just being troublemakers, or they agree with what you say, but they make it obvious that they're agreeing only because you're the boss and you can harm them. You know, I'm being obedient, I don't really care about what's going on. Then there are those genial types who will be willing to comply with anything that's said. They're not necessarily effective, they're not necessarily abrasive, they're not necessarily friendly, they're just willingly obliging whatever needs to be done. Then there are the three areas above the line in the green area. I cooperate, I'm happy about cooperating. I don't necessarily feel commitment, or I don't necessarily buy into what you're saying, but I'm happy about cooperating. The people who then have heartfelt commitment, they feel strongly for the business, they feel strongly for their teams. Most people in most newbie managers tend to be in this kind of an area because they're mostly in heartfelt commitment because you've just given them a promotion, you've given them a team to manage. They feel there's an emotional connection with that because there's a personal achievement associated with it, and therefore they feel committed. But your highest level people are the ones who live in the zone of creative excitement. These are the people who, if you remember when we talked about clarity in the first slide, on the extreme right, we talked about impact. You know, what is the impact that you're creating? What is the unique value that you're creating? What is your contribution to the business? The people who are in this zone of creative excitement are the most likely to give you results in that area. So it's really important as a leader to try and see, you know, where does your first-time manager stand on this scale? And then once you've figured out and you need to move him up on the scale towards a creative excitement level, then use the five leadership conversation techniques that we spoke about on the previous slide. This is a test that we must do. How engaged are our people or our managers? Because a disengaged manager again has a domino effect. A disengaged manager will almost entirely make sure that the people who work for him also become disengaged, because they'll keep talking about things that they shouldn't be talking about, or in a manner that they shouldn't be talking about. It's important to therefore figure out where these people are. Now, I make this statement because I've had at least a couple of situations where I promoted high potential people who'd been performing really well at an individual level into a management position, but on the day that they got promoted, or maybe very soon after they got promoted, I found that they had already reached a stage of fatigue. From where they were people who had reached their the zenith of their aspiration, at least their short term aspiration, and were no longer in a position to deliver on the three things above the line. They were just doing things in a willing compliance kind of way, just tired, fatigued, not interested, and that was a challenge because you just put them there, you had to justify why they were there, you had to make them perform, and they just wouldn't move. So it's important before getting people into your first-time manager positions to be able to assess what their engagement levels are, and to have a plan to take them up the ladder towards creative excitement. All right, so I'll just move on from here. How do you move somebody from a very willing level of commitment to creativity? I think it's important to start looking at some coaching conversations. It's not going to happen by just telling somebody, if you do this, then you could be a rock star. Or if you do that, you could be a rock star. I think that level of ownership needs to come from the individual himself. That path of discovery and that path of achievement needs to be defined by the individual himself. That's not a leadership conversation alone. It's what we call a coaching conversation. Right? How do you help your first-time managers to create their own statement of contribution? How do you get them to say, you know, if I were able to achieve such and such thing, or if I were able to contribute such and such thing to the business or to the people or to our customers or to our channel or to our, you know, processes in the factory or, you know, to our logistics, whatever business they're in, I think you set them on the path towards towards creativity very early in their you know, in their life as a manager. You're likely to see, you know, that's also the point at which the energy level and the commitment level to that job is the highest. So if you can put that contribution statement upfront when they have the highest level of commitment and energy, you know, you're multiplying your chances of getting these people to the highest level. And you know, the four boxes that you could that you could support them with, which are simply these: what's the need? What do I like doing? What do I do best? And therefore, or rather, what should I do and what should I not do? And between these four things, what am I good at? What do I like doing? What is the need of the market, or what is the need of my audience? And what should I be doing? Is where they will, you know, it gives them a framework to come up with what a strong contribution statement may be. Now, these are all very, you know, the leadership conversation, the coaching conversation. These are all very powerful tools in enhancing the potential of people, as is the performance management piece. Now, I know this, you know, this is a topic of discussion in many different ways. There are companies that have been using the traditional bell curve model, looking at performance, saying everybody is created equal, everybody is given an equal opportunity, and therefore whoever creates, whoever is more productive with that same capacity and that same capability is a high performer, and whoever is not a high performer. And then we try to apply some, you know, some realism to say, you know, this guy's territory is not that strong, or this guy's product line is not that big, or whatever it is, and therefore we normalize that a little bit. That's how performance management was done. It's pretty much top-down, where, you know, the leader decides what the goals are, and sometimes, you know, those goals may be unclear to the individuals. I mean, just yesterday we were, you know, two of us were sitting and having a drink with one of our customers' HR team, and they were really tearing their hair out about an issue, you know, where they've been driving customer centricity as a strategic priority of the CEO. And he says, you know, when I go to a guy who does the packaging from my factory in some place, and I say our company's number one strategy is customer centricity, that guy looks at me as though I'm talking some kind of gibberish which, you know, belongs to another planet. So when, you know, when things come top down, I mean, that is only one example. There were many others that we spoke about. When things come top down, very often they end up being relatively ambiguous, and you know, people who are doing a certain job seem to think that it has no consequence on whatever they are trying to do, and so they start feeling disconnected and completely disengaged with what they do. They only come to work because they have to earn a salary and pay their bills, and therefore they fall into an engagement level, which you could roughly translate to as willing cooperation. I'm just doing this because I have to do a job. There's no excitement, there's no creativity that I will bring to it, and nothing of the sort. Win-win performance management, on the other hand, is a new, you know, it's new to many companies. Many people actually follow it too, which is where, you know, there is a healthy discussion about between the leader and the manager. And now when a first-time manager comes into the picture, if you can give him that level of ownership, if you can give him that level of connection, emotional connection, with the goals he's setting, because he comes and sits down with you, his leader, and you give him the opportunity to say, right, let's have a discussion about what the goals should be and how you should measure your success and where they should take you, what contribution you should create. you are further fueling the possibility of you know, high level of energy, high sense of what he wants to contribute, and you're relating that now to exactly how he's going to go about it. So it's a new way of it's a new way of looking at it, and it's quite different from one where the new manager comes in and says, you know, the first time manager comes in and you tell him, here's what the goals of the team are, please go and run with it. I don't think there's a lot of buy-in that that comes in there. In fact, what comes in is a lot of pressure as a result of that. So it's a way of looking at what we want to do. But there are five important things in this, because at the end of the day, all of us are paid to get results. So the five components that go into that conversation, even if it's a win-win, win-win goal-setting conversation, is what are the results that we want? What are the guidelines or the framework within which you want to work? There is a certain set of resources you have. Therefore, whatever desired results you have to align with those resources. And you eventually have to be accountable for delivering that result, failing which there are consequences. And here are what the consequences are. So I think it's important to have that, you know, when you're looking at a win-win performance management discussion, it's important to keep these five components clearly in front of the concerned person. Yes, you contribute to what your performance management should be like, but at the end of the day, we work within an organization that has its set of goals, and we have to work within that. We have to work within that framework. So these components would help in creating that kind of a conversation. The last part that we spoke about was that it's one thing to set performance goals. It's one thing to hold people accountable. It's also important to enable them to be successful, especially when they come in fresh and they set, you know, people have a practice of setting 60-day goals, 90-day goals, and so on and so forth. And it's important to help new managers, first-time managers, to get those early wins in, because then your conversation, when you're having the leadership conversation about things like their worth and their ability and, you know, their accountability and things like that, it doesn't ring hollow in the ears of the first-time manager. You're helping them succeed, achieve, you know, wherever they're getting stuck, you're clearing the path. You're just helping them achieve some goals early, and of course later on too, but at least early, so that they get those early wins, so that your leadership conversations have a ring of, or rather have some heft, have some weight in them, and that sets the manager up, the first time manager up really well, to move from a newbie to delivering high quality performance and contribution. So we look at clear the path as a strong element or a strong tool in the hand of a leader. So that was pillar number three. How do you create employee engagement? How do you how do you enhance their potential? The fourth one is how do you create an environment for them to work in which they are able to drive the sustained superior results that we're looking at. It's important it's critical, in fact, for new managers to feel wanted and therefore to feel trusted. And it's great to create that kind of an environment for them. Now, traditional wisdom tells us that S, E, and R basically stand for strategy, execution, and results. So traditional wisdom tells us that strategy times execution, strategy multiplied by execution, should get you results. But there's a very important aspect that gets missed out on this, and that's the people factor. And the people factor is really the critical one, because if you really consider this equation, people don't follow strategy; they follow their leaders. If the leader says something, they will do it, even if it's moving some, even if it's a deviation from their strategy. It's an interesting thing. We just tend to follow the leader. So just because you have a strategy and you're executing against it is not going to guarantee results if your leader is not leading you in the same in the same direction. The other is other thing to take into account is that you may have great strategy, but if you have poor leadership, that's not giving you the direction and the support or the environment to get the job done. It's unlikely to lead to success. So the real equation looks something like this: strategy times execution multiplied by trust or a trusted environment is what's going to lead to sustained superior results. And trust is completely the people factor. It's people below, it's people above, and it's people around. Now, you know, when we look at trust, it's an interesting, it has some interesting outcomes. Now, there's something called a trust dividend, and I've taken this concept straight out of the Covey Foundation. This model comes from Franklin Covey. And it says that, you know, the trust dividend is that when trust is high in an organization, the speed of doing things is very high, and the cost of doing things is very low. The reason is simple. When trust is high, people make decisions. Fast decision-making improves speed, and it certainly reduces the cost of doing a transaction, any kind of a transaction. It doesn't have to be a commercial transaction. So it's really quite simple. If the trust levels are high, you will find the speed of doing business is high and the cost of doing business is low. Just imagine if you had to work with anybody in your organization and, you know, they would have to ask 20 people before they could come and give you their decision. Obviously, the speed would be slow. But if they could make those decisions because they knew that people in the back are going to back them for the decisions that they make because of a high level of trust, the speed of the decision will be fast. And if speed is fast, obviously the costs are going to be lower. The contrary to this is trust tax. So in environments where trust is low, the speed of doing things is slow. Why? Because everybody wants to cover their backside. You need 25 different signatures to do a simple thing like buy a table and a chair. Of course, the speed is going to be low, and the cost in terms of time is certainly going to be high. It may be high in terms of time multiplied by the cost of the resources that are being used within that time. So even in money terms, the cost could be significantly high. Interesting research that came out of the foundation also says that in empirical terms, that the impact of a 10% improvement in trust is equal to a 35% increase in pay, right? People say you increase somebody's salary, they're more likely to stay, they're more likely to be satisfied. But if you just improve trust, it costs you nothing. But look at the kind of impact it has on the ability to retain great employees and give them a great environment to work in. A lot of people tell me, you know, trust is a shapeless kind of thing. It has no structure. It has no, you either get people you can trust, or you don't, or you get people you can't trust. How do you build trust? That's a tough thing. The truth of the matter is that's not the case. Trust has a structure, and it's a very simple structure. That structure is that trust is built, and you know, trust can never be broken by one party alone. Trust is always broken equally by both parties. The second thing about the structure of trust is simple. Trust is made or broken by the way we behave. Now that makes it tangible, because behavior can be changed, provided you know what the behaviors are. And that's where the good news is, because there are many people who've created trust models. Here's one of them. This is the Reinhart Trust Model, and it's working on about 15 different behaviors. There are a few trust models in the market, but most of them sort of revolve around 13, 14, 15 behaviors of that closely reflect what's written here. I don't need to explain these behaviors, because we either learned these behaviors as kids, or we learned these behaviors within the first year or two of our professional lives. Whether we demonstrate these behaviors or not is going to determine whether we create the trusted environment that we need in an organization to enable our workforces, most importantly, people who are newly getting into decision-making positions, to be able to function effectively or not. And that's really what the main message behind creating a trusted environment is. As a leader, it becomes incredibly important, therefore, to communicate with people extensively, to be completely transparent with people within within the guidelines of the organization, obviously, but high level of communication, high level of trust with people in their ability to be able to do things. And that's where we are saying, you know, you build trust with people by having a leadership conversation. I mean, what are the leadership conversations? What is the coaching conversation about? When we talk about, you know, leveraging the potential of your first-time managers, The leadership conversations are about reaffirming trust, reaffirming faith in what they're doing. And that's, if you look at it, relates to the first, the triangle on the top, which is competence trust. The second part of it really said, you know, let's be absolutely transparent about what are the expectations and hold people accountable. That roughly corresponds to, to the green triangle on the left, which is communication trust. We're being very, very clear about what needs to be done. Then we talked about, you know, let's be clear about what the consequences are and what the expectations are. That's the third part of those conversations, and that roughly roughly aligns with the red triangle on the right, which is contractual trust. So your leadership conversations and your coaching conversations are the conversations that are going to help you create that that environment of trust that you want to give to your leaders, especially to your frontline or to your first-time managers. If you're able to use these four elements in tandem effectively, you know, give them clarity about what about the things that we spoke about, namely what's our organizational objective, what is your role objective, what is your impact that you're going to create. That's the clarity. Then we create the systems and the and the processes, or help them create the systems and the processes that basically follow the six building blocks that we spoke about. Then we have leadership conversations that reaffirm our trust in those people, set expectations and hold them accountable for those for the results, and help them when they need that. That ends up building the trust environment that we need for our first-time managers to perform effectively in the environment that we've been given. So, folks, that's the breadth of the content that I had today. And I'm open to taking any questions and answers that you might have.
Question and answer session. And